Poštovane dame i gospodo, dobar dan i dobrodošli na konferenciju poslovnog dnevnika Zeleni plan u hrvatskome gospodarstvu građevinarstvo. Cilj je potaknuti javnu raspravu o budućnosti građevinskog sektora. Danas ćemo govoriti o inflatornim pritiscima, nedostatku radne snage i obnovi nakon razornih potresa koja gotovo da stoji na mjestu već 2 godine. Molim glavnog urednika poslovnog dnevnika Vladimira Niševića da pozdravi skup.
Dame i gospodo, cijenjeni predstavnici građevinskog sektora, svi zainteresirani, evo lijepo vas pozdravljam u ime poslovnog dnevnika. Nije nam ovo prva konferencija, vjerujem da nije ni zadnja, pričali smo mi o građevini i prošle godine i godina koje su iza nas, ali svaki put smo nekako pričali u drugim okolnostima. Oni koji su sudjelovali prošle godine, ima vas tu, znaju da nam je glavni naglasak bio na obnovi područja pogođenih potresom. Pričat ćemo i danas o tome, ali evo i neke druge stvari su nas zadesile. Recimo da pomalo i nemamo sreće. Ova inflacija koja u ovom trenutku pogađa i građevinu kad razgovaramo o cijenama je vrlo izazovna i možemo reći vrlo opasna situacija. Situacija radne snage na koju i poslovni dnevnik i ostala Štirina izdanja ukazuju već isto tako niz godina je nešto što nas u svakom slučaju drži na mjestu i predstavlja sve veći i veći izazov, naročito kad govorimo o građevini. Danas ovdje gledat ćete mene barem na 2 panela, eto moram ja nešto i moderirati i raditi, pa zato neću duljiti. Ne znam kakve ćemo zaključke donijeti, nadam se da ćemo poslati neke optimistične poruke koliko god to u datoj situaciji bilo teško. Ipak je ovo sve dio priče zelenog plana, dio razgovora o europskim sredstvima, o projektima koje imamo priliku napraviti, o stvarima koje imamo priliku razviti, a na nama je u stvari da damo odgovor kako ćemo to učiniti, kada ćemo to učiniti i da li smo mi u ostalom kao Hrvatska sa 3,8 miliona stanovnika u ovom trenutku, ja ću otvoreno reći, to u stanju učiniti. Mi smo zvali predstavnike ministarstva danas da nam se ovdje pridruže, zvali smo im gotovo mjesec dana i evo jučer sam dobio finalnu obavijest da niko neće doći. Ne želim nikoga prozivati, ali mi je izrazito žao što predstavnici ministarstva danas nisu ovdje s nama, jer mislim da bi ipak oni najodgovorniji trebali ovdje sjediti i nešto reći. Ali mi ćemo svakako pokušati preko poslovnog dnevnika i ostalih Štirinih medija barem poslati jednu poruku di, kako i šta dalje. Ja vam još jednom zahvaljujem što ste došli i nadam se da će vam naša konferencija biti zanimljiva i sadržajna.
Hvala kolegi Niševiću. Radni dio počinjemo keynote prezentacijom odjeci zelenog plana na hrvatski građevinski sektor, koju će online održati Dimitrios Atanasiu iz Glavne uprave za energetiku Europske komisije. Good morning, Mr. Atanasiu. Can you hear me?
Good morning. Yes, I can hear you. I hope you can also hear me back.
Thank you for joining us today and welcome to our conference. Mr. Atanasiu, we are really eager to hear from you how the European Green Deal will affect the Croatian construction sector. So please, can you tell us a little bit more about it? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I will do my best. There are too many things happening at the same time, but I will try to provide you the overall political context of and to present to you what is happening in the Europe, in Brussels at the moment. Thank you very much for the invitation again and for giving us the chance to contribute to the discussion for improving the energy performance of the building sector. We are going through very challenging times indeed, but these times also present an opportunity to invest in a safe, environmental friendly and energy efficient future. In this geopolitical context, energy efficiency appears as one of the safest and cleanest way to reduce our reliance on fossil fuel imports from Russia especially, and succeed in this global clean energy transition at the same time. In line with the Repower EU ambitions, the package that presented by the European Commission last week, we must now double our efforts to reduce our dependence of imported fossil fuels well before the end of this decade. on buildings, which is the scope of this conference. This would mean to increase the rate and depth of renovations, but also increase buildings' energy performance, in particular by using more renewables in buildings. I have to mention before I start that buildings are very, very high in the political agenda all this period. The scope of the building sector is today much broader than it used to be some years ago. It is not anymore only about improving the energy performance and energy savings, but it is also about health, safety, energy poverty, affordable housing, sustainable living, integration of renewables, incorporating digital and smart solutions, creating jobs, and so many other things. This is simply because buildings bring multiple benefits to the economy, the society, and the environment. As you may know, buildings are responsible for about 40% of the EU's total energy consumption and for 36% of its energy-related greenhouse gas emissions from energy. Due to a well-established legislative framework for the energy performance of buildings and products, new buildings today are much more efficient than it used to be. However, existing buildings are very old and inefficient, and most of them will be standing by 2050. Almost two-thirds of the existing building stock in the EU is inefficient, and current renovation rates are only about 1%. The construction sector also generates about 9% of Europe's GDP and directly accounts for 18 million jobs. In addition, we also have to mention that buildings also have a big influence on EU citizens and households' economic conditions. As you may know, the Energy Performance of Buildings Directive is the basic tool to improve the energy performance of buildings. It was only a couple of years ago when the Clean Energy for All Europeans package achieved a comprehensive review of the energy legislation with the overall objective of putting energy efficiency first, driving clean energy technologies and systems, modernizing the framework to the 2030 goals, and placing citizens at the center. The European Green Deal took a step further by setting the vision for a fair and prosperous society and also make Europe carbon-free by 2050. The European Green Deal includes a series of initiatives that have a direct impact on the EU policy on energy efficiency and on renewable energy. In particular, in the 2030 Climate Target Plan, the Commission has proposed to cut net greenhouse gas emissions in the EU by at least 55% by 2030 as compared to 1990. This ambitious climate agenda of the current Commission provides a clear role for energy efficiency. However, without a significant contribution from the building sector, the new energy and environmental goals will not be met. Indeed, the building sector is one of the areas where efforts must be ramped up, exactly because there is a huge potential for energy savings. This is why, among other initiatives, the Commission announced the Renovation Wave Initiative as part of the European Green Deal, with the objective to at least double the annual energy renovation rate of residential and non-residential buildings by 2030. This would mean to quality renovate almost 35 million buildings by 2030 in Europe. In addition, in order to meet these new climate targets, direct emissions from buildings will have to decrease by almost 90% by 2040. For that reason, the Commission proposed to revise the directive, the Energy Performance of Buildings Directive, as part of the Fit for 55 package, which is the delivery package of the European Green Deal. The renovation of existing buildings is the core of this revision, with ambitious measures such as setting minimum energy performance standards to trigger energy efficient renovation of buildings, starting with those of worst performance. We also propose to introduce requirements for new buildings to become zero emission buildings from 2030, replacing the existing norm of nearly zero energy buildings. The proposals also includes enhanced long-term renovation strategies to be renamed national building renovation plans, and also support access to quality information with increased reliability, quality, and digitalization of energy performance certificates, with energy performance classes to be based on common criteria, with a definition of deep renovation and the introduction of building renovation passports. The EPPD, Energy Performance of Buildings Directive, reinforces the role of buildings to become an integral part of the energy system. We have also proposed to phase out fossil fuel-based heating to enhance the use of digitalization and smart technologies in buildings for heating, cooling, ventilation, and also promote energy communities and the use of renewable-based district heating solution, as well as mobility recharging infrastructure. On top of these proposals, and in order to facilitate the current situation with the energy crisis, many elements of the REPowerEU are very relevant for buildings policy as well. It includes short-term measures to reduce gas use in buildings and accelerate building renovation and its financing. It also promotes the rollout of heat pumps and solar solutions in buildings in line with the EU Save Plan and the EU Solar Strategy. Very quickly to be noted that as part of the REPowerEU, the Commission proposes to enhance long-term energy efficiency measures, including an increase of the binding energy efficiency target from 9 to 13%. The Commission also published an EU energy saving communication detailing short-term behavioral changes which could cut gas and oil demand by 5%, and encourage member states to start specific communication campaigns targeting households and industry. The Commission also proposes as part of the REPowerEU to increase the headline 2030 target for renewables from 40 to 45%. Setting this overall increased ambition will create the framework for other initiatives, including a dedicated EU solar strategy to double solar photovoltaic capacity by 2050, and the solar rooftop initiative with a phased-in legal obligation to install solar panels on new public and commercial buildings and new residential buildings. It is now up to the Council and the European Parliament to agree on a text that works best for all, and contributes adequately to both our short-term objective of minimizing imports of fossil fuels and also our long-term ambition of becoming climate neutral by 2050. Of course, achieving all these ambitions will require investments. The Commission will continue to support member states and stakeholders as they implement the European Green Deal. We're working on all fronts, policies, financing, technical support, and overcoming barriers to renovations. Significant resources from the EU budget are available from both the long-term EU budget, the MFF 2021-2027, and the EU Recovery and Resilience Facility. The Commission, together with member states, is now looking at the possible revision of the national recovery and resilience plans to make use of the unused RRF loans, in particular for energy efficiency investments in buildings, SMEs, and district heating. We don't start from scratch. Already over 65, 64 billion euros have been dedicated to energy efficiency investments in the national RRPs, recovery and resilience plans, the majority of it for building renovations. Additional streams of financing and policy updates, such as the proposed social and climate fund, which is expected to mobilize 72.2 billion euros for the period 2025 up to 2032, and the REPowerEU plan are also important alongside the mobilization of private finance, of course. The Commission also proposes to make targeted amendments to the national recovery plans to integrate dedicated REPowerEU chapters in member states' existing recovery and resilience plans, in addition to the large number of relevant reforms and investments which are already in the plans. The most suitable projects, investments and reforms at national, regional, and EU level are being discussed and identified in dialogue with member states. As regards energy efficiency, these measures aiming to step up building renovation of the building stock, the supply of energy efficiency housing, in particular social housing, and the replacement of gas and oil boilers with heat pumps and other more efficient and green solutions. With the REPowerEU, including the EU Solar Strategy and the EU Savings Plan, there is a window of opportunity to ensure that the rollout of crucial equipment such as heat pumps and solar panels is combined with insulation of the building envelope. Croatia has great potential to increase its energy efficiency, in particular in the building sector, as well as in district heating and cooling. According to the long-term renovation strategy, Croatia has significantly increased its ambition for annual renovation rate from 0.7% to 3% by 2030, aiming for energy renovation investments in multi-dwelling buildings, family homes, public buildings, cultural buildings, also buildings that needs seismic reinforcement. Croatia's National Energy and Climate Plan estimates investments since to around 19 billion euros for the period 2021 up to 2030, corresponding to almost 3.5% of the GDP. The majority of these investments are planned for energy efficiency in the building sector, construction renovation, and electricity production. The implementation of the recovery and resilience plans of Croatia is expected to contribute and make further progress on the green and digital transition. In particular, the measures supporting the climate objectives in Croatia account for almost 40.3% of the plan's total allocation, while measures supporting digital objectives account for almost 20.5% of the plan's total allocation. Although the recovery plans allocate significant funds for to energy renovation, it's clear that this is not enough for Croatia to reach its 3% renovation target. This is why additional funds will be allocated in the next MFF framework and possible from other EU funds. In order to close this financing gap, we also support Croatia in its intention to develop financial instruments for financing renovation for the period until 2030. The successful implementation of the Recovery and Resilience Facility and Cohesion Policy programs also depends on the removal of bottlenecks to investments to support the green and digital transition and balanced territorial development. Croatia has already exceeded its target for renewable energy, but there is a lot of untapped potential to exploit wind and solar power as well. Therefore, Croatia can take the opportunity of the renovation wave and the REPowerEU and allocate more budget for buildings renovations, not only to cover the high demand, but also to contribute to the efforts needed to respond to the current situation with the Ukraine war and in order to achieve the 2050 targets at the same time. The measures in the REPowerEU plan can respond to the double urgency to end the EU's dependency on Russian fossil fuels and tackle the climate crisis. This can be done through energy savings, diversification of energy supplies, and accelerated rollout of renewable energy to replace fossil fuels at home. The systematic involvement of social partners and other relevant stakeholders remain important, and therefore this is why the events like the conference today is very important for the successful implementation of the recovery and resilience plans. Having said all that, I gave my best to present to you the overall situation with regards to the energy policy of buildings in Europe. I have to say that there are many, many things happening every day, exactly because we're negotiating the Fit for 55 package, which includes the Energy Performance of Building Directive, which also includes the Renewables Directive, EU ETS system, and Energy Efficiency Directive. So all this, we try to combine all this together with the situation with Ukraine and make the best out of it. It is important that we keep the momentum, and we try to further facilitate our efforts towards building renovation. Thank you very much again for the invitation, and I wish all the best for the rest of it. Many thanks.
Mr. Athanasio, thank you for sharing with us all those valuable information, and have a nice and fruitful rest of the day. Thank you.
Many thanks.
Hvala lijepa gospodinu Athanasiju, a sada slijedi prezentacija pregled usvojenih posebnih uzanaca o građenju koju će održati savjetnica predsjednika Hrvatske gospodarske komore za promet i graditeljstvo Mirjana Čagalj.
Dobar dan. Danas ću vam prezentirati posebne uzance o gradnji. Naime, to je dokument kojeg je donijela Hrvatska gospodarska komora zajedno sa Hrvatskom udrugom poslodavaca, a usvojena je na prijedlog i uz suglasnost Ministarstva graditeljstva prije možda jedno pola godine, odnosno krajem prošle godine. Uzance imaju 100 i nešto uzanci, nešto su manjem obimu nego što su bile prošle iz 1977. godine. Ja ću vam iz njih izdvojiti samo onaj dio koji se odnosi najviše na povećanje cijena i kako naplatiti razliku od cijena što je uzancama donekle obrađeno, što ne postoji u Zakonu o obveznim odnosima, niti vam se to nalazi u javnoj nabavi. Radna skupina je počela sa radom 2016. godine i to u skladu sa člankom 199 Zakona o gradnji koji je donesen 2014. godine. Održano je više od 45 sjednica, više od 20 javnih skupova, provedene su ankete, anketirano je više od 1000 građevinara i investitora u graditeljstvu. Postoje par interesantnih stvari koje su kontradiktorne i proturječne jedna drugoj, pa tako Zakon o obveznim odnosima kaže da se uzanca automatski primjenjuje ako se ugovorom ne isključi, dok članak 219 Zakona o javnoj nabavi kaže obrnuto, da je uzanca isključena, odnosno isključena je primjena posebnih uzanci u graditeljstvu, osim ako se izrijekom ne uključi. Nove uzance su objavljene u Narodnim novinama 137/21, 13.12.2021. godine i s time uzanca broj 106 ili kako je lakše svima članak 106, tim danom su prestale važiti uzance iz 1977. godine, što je bio jako stari dokument koji nije bio prilagođen novome načinu poslovanja. Uzanca broj 177 kaže da se nove uzance primjenjuju na ugovore sklopljene nakon 22.12.2021. godine, iako mišljenje je mnogih pravnih stručnjaka da bi se one trebale primjenjivati i na sve ugovore retroaktivno, budući da to nije ni zakon ni propis, nego je stvarno isključivo samo trgovački običaj. Peti dio uzanci, peto poglavlje, govori o cijenama. Niti jedna uzanca, niti odredba članka 627 Zakona o obveznim odnosima ne daje regulaciju za priznanje razlike u cijeni. Kažemo da ne može postojati univerzalno rješenje za svaki ugovor, a iz dosadašnjeg iskustva i presude, odnosno sudačke prakse, što možemo naći na internetu, članak 627 Zakona o obveznim odnosima je nejasan i oni ga različito tumače. Naime, i prije možda godinu dana smo dobili tumačenje ministarstva da se promjena cijene, odnosno povećanje materijala, ipak odnosi na sveukupnu cijenu, a ne na jediničnu cijenu. Iako je čitavome građevinskome svijetu jasno da ako se ugovori o pojediničnoj cijeni, da se povećanje odnosi na jediničnu cijenu, a ne na sveukupnu cijenu ugovora. No međutim, taj dio moram reći da možda pravnicima nije najjasniji, posebno ne onome dijelu koji se baš ne bavi graditeljstvom, nego se bavi sa svim drugim. Kada izvođač ima pravo potražiti razliku u cijeni materijala, a nije ništa ugovoreno? I stare i nove uzance prepoznaju izmjenu ugovorene cijene zbog promijenjenih okolnosti i izrijekom navode da to može biti zbog promjena cijena materijala, dok Zakon o obveznim odnosima je malo nejasan i govori o pojmu elemenata, pri tome ne definira baš točno što je element te cijene. Ranije važeća uzanca predviđala je različite postotke kod povećanja cijene materijala, a nova uzanca detaljnije navodi uvjete za povećanje i daje jedinstvene postotke. Prema novim uzancama, sada je 2% rizik izvođača kod promjenjive cijene, a 3% kod nepromjenjive, dok Zakon o obveznim odnosima predviđa 2%, odnosno 10% kada ste ugovorili fiksnu cijenu. Izmjena uzanca broj 18 govori o izmjeni ugovorene cijene. Svaki ugovaratelj, ako dođe do promijenjenih okolnosti koji utječu na cijenu, ima pravo promijeniti ugovorenu cijenu. Te promjenjive okolnosti su ovdje definirane šta je to, kada je vrijeme sklapanja ugovora, ako se nisu mogle predvidjeti, ako se njihovo nastupanje nije moglo izbjeći, niti djelovanje ukloniti. Dakle, taksativno se nabraja 4 slučajeva promijenjenih okolnosti, od čega je jedan promjena cijena građevnih proizvoda, opreme, usluga na tržištu, što se upravo ovu i prošlu godinu i dešava. Uzanca broj 19 kaže da izvođač može zahtijevati povećanje jedinične cijene i to ako je radove izveo u roku, u vremenu od davanja ponude do ispunjenja, bez utjecaja izvođača ako se desila promjena, iako su se povećale cijene pojedinih elemenata na temelju kojih je određena jedinična cijena pojedine stavne troškovnika. Ta cijena trebala bi biti veća za više od 2%. Službeni podaci koje možete koristiti, koji su navedeni u uzancama, su podaci Državnog zavoda za statistiku i podaci Hrvatske gospodarske komore. Postavlja se pitanje tko je još kriv, odnosno tko treba pratiti razliku u cijeni za onaj period između davanja ponude i sklapanja ugovora, odnosno u konkretnijem slučaju kod javne nabave od trenutka otvaranja ponude do odabira izvođača. Zakon o obveznim odnosima je tu decidiran i kaže da se i traženje promjene cijene može isključivo tražiti od trenutka potpisa ugovora. Međutim, u Zakonu o javnoj nabavi, možete ga pročitati, postoji jedan članak koji kaže da je cijenu od trena kad se otvori ponuda, vi više cijenu ne smijete mijenjati. I članak kaže isto tako, ako je firma dovedena u poslovanje takvo da je doveden u pitanje projekat ili poslovanje firme, postoji način da vi zatražite i povećanje promjene cijene od trenutka otvaranja ponude do potpisa ugovora, a prosjek javne nabave u Hrvatskoj od otvaranja ponude do potpisivanja ugovora iznosi 9 mjeseci. U tih 9 mjeseci onaj koji je upao u 2021. godinu, materijali su mu poskupili preko 200% neki. Zahtjev, ne možete zahtijevati razliku u cijeni ako su se te promijenjene okolnosti nastupile nakon isteka roka i za ispunjenje. Onda se utvrđuje najprije ko je kriv za to kašnjenje, tek kad se utvrdi onda možete ili ne smijete potraživati razliku u cijeni. Uzance i javna nabava. Javni naručitelj bi se trebao već u prethodnom savjetovanju odrediti hoće li primjenjivati uzance, članak 219 Zakona o javnoj nabavi, i to treba učiniti najkasnije u objavi dokumentaciju za nadmetanje, jer ugovor o građenju mora biti sklopljen temeljem uvjeta kojeg je on prikazao u dokumentaciji. Današnji najveći problem potraživanja te razlike u cijeni, što kod ugovaranja fiksne cijene u dokumentaciji za nadmetanje nije navedena formula po kojoj ćete vi klizati, odnosno obračunavati tu razliku u cijeni, i to je nešto što je kod SAFU-a ostao do dana današnjeg prijepor na kako to napraviti. Također bih vam preporučila, ukoliko imate bilo kakvih prijepora, da možete koristiti i sudište pri Hrvatskoj gospodarskoj komori. I također vam, s obzirom da smo ovdje navedeni kao neko ko daje indekse materijala i podatke o kretanju materijala, zadnjih 6 mjeseci smo napravili povijesne rezultate kretanja cijene materijala za 2020. 2021. i sad radimo 2022. Vodimo oko 150 materijala, tako da kogod hoće zatražiti može dobiti indekse i temeljem njih tražiti povećanje cijena. Evo, toliko, hvala na pažnji.